Father, it's days like this, and it is this day, that we feel so very blessed. You gave your Son, you've given us your heart, given us your Spirit, you've asked us to be like you. Father, when we've stumbled, when we've fallen, you're willing to take us back. We know what love is, because it comes from you. Lord, we're thankful for that. We ask your blessings on us. We are grateful for your provision. We're grateful for the health that we have. We ask you to give us the help that we need. Father, help us to reflect your light to people around us. And may we glorify and honor your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
If you open your Bibles to 1 Peter 3, we will be in 1 Peter 3. To give the reason you have, but do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. Now, you're probably wondering, how does that verse fit that illustration that you used? And it's just this simple. Since Jesus has received the sting of death that we were to receive, and we realize what a wonderful thing he has done for us, what will be our response? That's the point of the Bible class. What will be our response? Can anyone define for me the word anthem? Anthem. What is an anthem?
Song.
Song? A particular song.
Isn't it a banner of some sort?
A little banner. An anthem.
Declaration.
A declaration. This is really good. The term anthem, we normally think of our national anthem. You know, before the game, before the big game, we sing, we have someone sing, or we join singing the national anthem. An anthem is usually a musical composition that will identify a nation. We're watching the Olympics, and we see who got the gold and the silver and the bronze. We get three different anthems. We hear them. An anthem originally was a form of church music. The words are selected from Holy Scripture and are generally more elaborate and varied than that of hymns. An anthem often refers to any sort of sacred choral work presented during the course of a worship service. So that's an official definition of what an anthem is. But when I think of the two verses, I didn't show you verse 16. This is why I love to put the clicker in somebody else's hand. Because I'm thinking about what I want to say. What do you mean I have to slow down to remember to hit the button? Three slides later.
Peter 3:15-16.
in your heart. Does he reign in your heart, it says. The idea being this is a personal thing. Does Jesus reign in the church? Yes, 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 yes. We'll say yes. But what happens on Monday when I'm away from church and Tuesday and Wednesday? They used to talk about having a throne of your heart. Does Jesus, here's the question, does he sit on the throne of your heart? And go, that's strange. But according to what Peter's saying, it's not strange, it's perfectly logic. We have this struggle for who's king? Who's Lord of our lives? Jesus should be. Jesus wants to be. But we have to let him. There's often this struggle. Is it going to be Jesus? Or is it going to be Alan, who is my king? Like you, I want it to be Jesus. And like you, sometimes it is just a struggle to keep this man from being the boss of this man's life. Let Jesus be Lord in your heart. Where it says, revere Christ as Lord, that revere literally means reverence. Reverence, translated in some places, set aside Christ as Lord. It means to be set aside for the Lord's service, for God's service. But it literally means to reverence him, to set apart yourself for God. Lord, Greek word kurios, kurios meaning having power or authority. Having power in what way? Power over death. Authority in what way? Authority over everything. He calmed the sea, but authority over my life choices. And so I go to Casting Crowns song, my life song. Same for you. Because it's his authority. Our anthem number 2. Be prepared to answer. Verse 15 says, be prepared to answer when they ask you what your hope is. When they see your life is different. And they see you have this life song. And they say, who, what, when, where, why? And you say, it's Jesus. Be ready to answer. It's okay to default sometimes and say, why don't you go to church with me? I mean, we want to bring people with us to get to know God on a deep level and to worship with us. But you know what? There are places that you're going to be that I never want to be. There are people that you're going to have a relationship, intimate relationships with, that I'll never be introduced to. You can't wait for me. You can't wait for Abe to be the one who does all the speaking to whoever it is. You've got to be ready to answer the question about why you have hope for eternity. And that's part of the song that we sing with our lives. We're making Lord number one. We are ready to answer and tell people the good news, because it's not just a good news story, it's a good news relationship, and our relationship is with a living Jesus. Our anthem, be prepared to answer. We have an anthem also of hope. The hope, still in verse 15, is the why. Our God is a God of hope, and people want to know the reason for that hope. And Peter says, when you tell them, make sure you do it with courtesy. Do it with respect. Because people that don't know God can be antagonistic towards God. Couldn't we just stop and start sharing stories of antagonism about people who were not believers, who saw that you were somehow, and they made fun of you, or they said something to you, and it was rude, and it was antagonistic. Peter was a man of passion. He was a man that saying that when we encounter someone that has been discourteous to us, but we're talking about our Lord and the reverence that we need to give to Him, be ready to deliver it in a courteous way because you want to share your hope with Him. You don't want to just keep it for yourself. Our anthem is one of a clear conscience, verse 16. One that would reject evil and embrace good. Because they will slander, Peter's saying. And he says, well, and if you have evil in your life, then why shouldn't they slander? You don't have anything to stand on. So he says, just don't do those kind of things. Put those away. Reject that. So when they do slander you, they won't have anything truthful to say, and you'll have a clear conscience. So our anthem is also an anthem of purity. Our life song is one that says, I may not be good at being pure, but I know I've been called to purity by the pure one, and I'm going to do two things. I'm going to seek and strive to be righteous. And when I stumble and fall out of righteousness, that's when I'm going to head back to the Master. I said, Lord, please, clean me again. Our anthem's an anthem of purity. Let me see. I've got a bonus verse. And that's verse 14. I didn't have that on screen. But I'd like you to look at 1 Peter 3 and verse 14. It says, but even if you should suffer for doing what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear. Do not be frightened. And then we'll go into 15. But set in your hearts Christ is Lord, and always be prepared to give that answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have, and do it in gentleness and respect, keeping that clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against you will be ashamed of their sin. So I want to go back to that verse 14, because of what is said there, even if you should suffer for doing what is right, you are blessed. Don't fear their threats, and don't be frightened. Part of the anthem that we sing with our life song to Christ is one of courage, because there are things in this life that we can be fearful of. But you know, our Jesus was brave. Our Jesus was a manly man. For him to go and endure what he endured before the cross, for him to endure what he endured on the cross, hopefully you've never seen a crucifixion. I haven't. They're happening again in the Middle East nowadays to Christians, to believers. It's a terrible thing. I'm not even going to try and describe it to you. But he goes through the pain of the beating, and then spends the hours on the cross, and then instead of dying, having his life taken, he bows his head and says, it's finished. No man shall take my life. I give it, and I give it freely. Our Lord is a man of courage. And it never fails. We live life as just a normal life. We get up, we go to work, maybe you hit the time clock, maybe you're not on the time clock. And it can be some ho-hum average. But the day comes when there's an accident and you have to help somebody. Or your neighbor is hurt at home. Or you just think of your life, that special day when something unexpected happened and you were called upon to step up. There are sometimes we don't think we're big enough men to do it. There are sometimes we don't think we are big enough women to do it. Jesus was one man because he was not afraid to say, Father, if this cup can pass, let it pass. He's in the garden. He's praying. He does not want to go through the cross, that whole episode. But if it cannot pass, let your will be done. And he goes. I think the anthem of our lives, as far as reverencing him, sharing hope with others, and trusting him, has to end up with courage. Because the day's going to come when we get called to be Jesus in the world to someone in a real way. And the only way we're going to get through it is with courage. And it may be a dad and how he treats his children. It may be a husband and how he treats his wife. Or vice versa, mothers, wives. I can't tell you when it's going to come. But I can tell you this, when you get to the end of that day, like the Casting Crowns song said, I want you to sign your name to the end of this day because he wants his love to be true. That life song is the correct anthem that we read about in 1 Peter chapter 3. Now, your thoughts on that verse. I did a lot of talking because I don't want to stay. And I can't be like this. If nothing was evoked just by listening to the verses, let me just encourage you. If you have that Casting Crowns CD somewhere, pull it out because that's my old song now. And listen to it. And if some of you that have never heard of whoever that Casting Crowns people are, the idea is picture revelation. They're going to take their crowns off in eternity and lay them at his feet. They wouldn't have that crown. See if you can find some of these younger people to bring their CD by and play it for you. And see if this kind of thought doesn't help encourage us to live that kind of lifestyle and sing that kind of life anthem. Now, since I'm a new kid on the block, this is Bible class. We don't need to have an invitation, do we? We don't. And Tom, how do we want to shift over into your portion of questions and answers?
Well, why don't you and Lisa just tell us a little bit about yourself, and then naturally the questions will come.
Okay. I am the luckiest man in the world because Lisa agreed to be my wife. And I've got a neighbor. We live in a set of five condos. We're on the west side. I've got a good friend over down on the east side. And he looks at me and says, we both are married way above our station. And I say, you're so right. Lisa has been my partner. She has been the mother of our two sons. When I've been involved in ministry pursuits, whether it was teaching or getting a lesson ready or traveling the world, Lisa's been the one that has stayed and been the right kind of example to our sons when I couldn't be because of the work that I was doing. She's been the perfect partner with me when we have traveled, when we have worked in outreach, and when we've worked in churches. So, talk about ourselves, I'm going to talk about her. Anyone say anything? Here's the microphone. Watch this.
Okay. Yeah, I'm just turning your voice. I'm going to go there.
Yeah,
you
will.
Precious, and all your grandmas could just not.
Zoe in Ohio went to her mother and picked up the phone and said, Nana. And she says, you want to call Nana? Yeah. So it's on the dials, calls the house, I answer the phone. Zoe wants to talk to Nana. So my grace, this is granddad. I'm sorry, Nana is not here. Nana! Nana! Maybe they're like this.
It's
call from a mission church in Seattle, Washington, to go. We had a 10-year contract to go and see what we can do out there. We went and worked with a 50-member church. There were about 95 when we left, and some Sundays we'd be up to 125. But going to Seattle, people are different. I mean, you think they're different when we go to New York? New York is not Terre Haute. Let me tell you, Seattle is not New York. It was different, but it was also an experience. And that's how Stephen got Seattle. He started working in the computer industry. And when Dad's next ministry opportunity took him elsewhere, Stephen said, "Dad, I'm staying here. This is a cool place to be. I got a job. I got a girlfriend." Don't forget to call. And so, because we're very connected to our sons, like we are reconnected family-wise, we have a built-in reason to visit Seattle, Washington.
Does any of the questions we sent to you on our questionnaire stick out in your mind? Most people here haven't seen your questionnaire.
I don't have the questionnaire with me, and that was almost 2 months ago that I filled it out. It sounded like the church that was looking for a stable minister, and that doesn't mean they weren't stable, or Cora wasn't stable. I'm not buying that at all. Just, you are loved, brother.
You mentioned Cookville.
Uh-huh.
You know Clarence DeLoach?
Yes.
He's a dear friend. I haven't seen him for years.
We were young enough. Clarence was a minister in one of the churches there, and we decided to marry him. And we intended to ask him to perform a wedding ceremony, and he was out of pocket and away, and another fellow was taking his place for a while. We asked him to perform our wedding ceremony, so we just barely missed having him, tired or not.
He was in Marietta, Ohio. Mm-hmm. We were just about 60 miles up the road. We used to do church camp together.
Excellent.
And the reason I appreciate Clarence the way I do, you know, in the church you always hear of liberals and conservatives, and either way, you know, this and that. Clarence was always stable, just right from the middle, and never messed with any of that stuff. And I have to assume he's still the same way.
I think so. And I'll tell you more Clarence DeLoach stories when we're not online. All right? Your question about my career path. When we finished Seattle, we started a ministry called Worship Renewal Resources. With the traveling and all the churches we've been in and the church growth work we had done, we started assisting churches that were either struggling to grow or had had difficulties. And what that looks like is oftentimes an eldership, because they're not trained in the same way that preachers are, to go to school for 4 years or 6 years or beyond. They're good men, and they're qualified men according to the scriptures, but sometimes something can just pop up in a church that you're shepherding that you need some help with. And so we've made ourselves available for consultation to churches, and we've had contracts with several, and we've done that for several years. But we've missed the day-in, day-out fellowship of having a church family of our own, and so we made the decision that we're looking for a church that we can shift back into, that we feel like the Lord will call us to, that is ready for someone to help them grow. That's our desire. Not just grow in numbers. We want to grow in numbers, but we want to grow in spirit also. We want to grow in spiritual maturity. So that's our career path too today. Questions?
I can turn this off if you need me to.
I don't know who's got a German background here. Let me tell you.
And the
they just took such good care of us and just went above and beyond. And I had no idea what the homes in these places were like in Recife was like until one of the moms and her two late 20-somethings, early 30-somethings daughters invited us over for lunch. They were so excited that we were going to their house for lunch, and they just put on, it wasn't a huge spread or anything, but the missionaries told us later on how much it had cost them to do that. And it was, you know, it was like a big, really big deal. It would be the equivalent of putting on Thanksgiving or Christmas for your family and all the extra expense you go to. So I just, the hospitality of the folks in Brazil and Mexico, that's immediately what I thought of when you asked that question.
I thought you were just mesmerized by the word. I think this congregation is biblically founded. I think you have a foundation of people that are set to grow. I see what we're going to do in church health evaluations for churches. Sometimes we'll go in having contracted with leaders, and we're coming, people won't know who we are while we're there. We just come in as visitors. So we don't walk into a church without that kind of eye on it. I know that this gap of young families here is one of the first things you have to address, whether I come here or somebody else comes here. And I think the way that's done is, this is my opinion. I'm not the only one with answers, okay? But I think we're going to take the young couples that are available, here's one, and start building a foundation of reaching out to other young couples, helping them reach out to other young couples, and bringing in and teaching that way. I think that's the first answer to that gap. So I believe that you're basically a spiritually healthy church that's poised to grow. Let me give you a freak. We get invited to come to churches that have problems very often. And usually when their attendance is going down or they've had a division or some kind of blow up or something's wrong, everybody tells us they want to grow. But they don't want to address the things that it takes to get past the problem to have the growth. So don't just say we want to grow. Everybody wants to grow. But how bad do we want to grow? Do we want to grow enough to address our issues if we have issues and do it? And if you're willing to put yourself in the Lord's hands that way, there's no way you won't grow. The Lord's church grows. I think congregations can be like a physical body that are born and die. But some of those spiritual bodies are very long-lived if they're walking, holding the Lord's hand, instead of trying to figure things out on our own. Because when we figure things out on our own, our human frailties get involved. And that's when we get weak and frail. Next question.
You answer everything as you go along.
I have a question.
Yes.
Do you want Lithium?
I like this place.
Yes, that's one question. Do you really want Lithium?
Here's my thing. I'm saying, Lord, you show me the place that you want me to be, and that's where I'm going. Now, so I don't find this place as foreign territory.
It's been years and years.
Yes.
One of the ladies asked me this yesterday in our sessions, and I think probably a really good additional way to put it would be, we don't take transition lightly, because that's one of the things we work in. We work in transition with churches, and we see how healthy transition can be done and how it can be done in maybe an unhealthy way. So personally, as a couple, we don't take any ministry transition lightly.
That's right. If we make a move, we know God's hand is on it. I don't have any red flags waving me saying, don't go here. Is that adequately answering?
Yes.
Very good. Elders told me you were going to ask me questions that were grilling. I guess that's as close as it's going to be. Jesus was standing here, and I don't want to presume anything. But I think he would say, well done. He knows what I don't know. Where he needs to correct you, he'd correct you. But I say loving spiritual hearts. Tim, you have a question?
You answered it earlier. Just, you know, what first attracted you to the position? What led to that decision to find a church home, and what led you here? That was, you've touched on all of those aspects already.
Hey, have you had much experience in working with older senior ministers?
Working with older senior ministers? No. Working with older seniors, yes. If I come here, don't give me a hard time, bro. one of the last churches we helped get over the hump in the road, one of the elders that had formerly served them and moved away because of his job situation was still much loved and would come back on a semi-regular basis. So I got to know him, he got to know me. And he cornered me one day between Bible class and sermon time and said, how do you do it? I said, how do I do what? He said, I've watched you with the teenagers this morning, and they like you. And I've watched you with, I won't say that, but he called a certain octogenarian's name, who was kind of the local curmudgeon. And I know I'm fine with him too. He said, how do you do that? I said, well, I'm just treating people with respect. I should try to show some genuine interest, and it's worked so far. So, yes, I like older people. You know what? Every day I live, I'm getting closer to them. But I like younger people too, because their spirits are fresh, and their eyes are filled with wonder. All right. How about it, Randy? You got something?
No, you've answered everything that I can think of.
I would love it to leave Elder speechless. Thank you.
You've been working with churches.
here. As far as actively looking for consultation opportunities, I would not, because I've been engaged in a volunteer. As I was explaining how we do this at our dinner here in the evening, we can go in and sit down with the leadership, work with them, do some evaluations of the congregation, help them through issues, go into a period of consultation where we are available by phone, and then we come to an end contractually to that agreement, because we may be a congregation, but we are one church, and it's His church. Never in those relationships, you know, if somebody calls, I would answer. But no,